70 years ago, two comics were launched that would bring magic to generations of children.
I used to love those spreads of food and the Christmas issues where they had sort of false snow.
It was that jolly, bouncy logo and the smell and the tactile quality of it. It was just the right shape, feel and look for a little kid.
The Dandy and the Beano were full of characters so funny and alive they became as much a part of childhood as sweets and knits.
We're looking through this, you've got so many iconic characters. Lord Snooty, Minnie the Minx, the Bash Street Kids, Dennis the Menace.
Great slaps, Dink. Stop, stop. Here's your mother's best dinner plates.
I love Little Plum. Just wonderful.
Desperate Dan. Look, Uncle Dan has been out and got himself an outsized lolly.
Mirth and Magic were produced in an industrial fun factory north of the border, where comic genius was at work in the shape of four very different artists.
Some chemistry just brought this group of guys into the one sphere at the one time. They struck sparks off one another. The effect was magical.
These artists, with their scriptwriters, invented whole worlds of feasting and fun. Worlds where grown-ups were terrorised and kids ruled. But though comics sold in millions, you, dear reader, were unaware of the artists behind them.
I wasn't really aware that there were different artists as a child. I wasn't really aware that people drawed, to tell you the truth.
So who were these invisible heroes? And what part did they play in the grinding production line process that created Comic Heaven? In the freezing winter of 1937, a Scottish publisher launched an early Christmas present for children. The Dandy was a brand new humour comic. For tuppence, you got a free gift, adventure stories, and cartoon strips with speech bubbles, all part of a bold new format.
The Dandy was revolutionary because it actually had full colour, it had a compact format, half tabloid, you could stuff it in the back of your pocket, and it had, above all, lively, dynamic comics, real comics, not the stuff with acres of text on each panel. These were comics that were alive and would draw you in with, often actually with speech boosts, but sometimes pure pantomime, where there was nothing to read, where the pictures did all the storytelling.
Speech balloons were the key innovation. Before the Dandy, comics used to look like this, demanding lots of reading. Now they look like this, wordy text replaced by a modern, some might say vulgar, American-style strip. It was an attention-grabbing formula to appeal to young readers.
If a comic strip is told with word balloons, the action just flows so much more quickly. If you stop to read the text, it's just sort of one step up from an illustrated book. With word balloons, the action seems to sort of zap straight into your brain.
Here's the Dandy comic number one. December the 4th, 1937. A rather worn copy, but you can see how bright the colours are. Let's go into the first page. And what have we got? He's the toughest of the tough. Watch our Danny do his stuff.
Desperate Dan, my favourite.
Desperate Dan was a freakishly strong cowboy whose character was the product of two fashionable crazes of 1930s Britain.
Desperate Dan is desperate because he's a desperado. He's a cowboy strongman, because at the time you have the whole interest in the circus strongman, the muscle-bound character. Then you also have the mixture with, of course, the cowboy. Wild West characters in film and in fiction were all the rage around this period.
Dan's superhuman strength was a never-ending source of humour, providing weekly adventures bursting with invention.
Desperate Dan's mighty lick makes lollies vanish mighty quick. He hasn't got one lolly, he's got like about 25 lollies there, because obviously, you know, look at his enormous tongue. Everything about Desperate Dan is bigger, even his kind of libidinous desires are bigger, aren't they?
Dan would do gigantic things. He actually invaded a country armed with a cheese.
In the stories, Dan lived in the American town of Cactusville. But on closer inspection, Cactusville looked awfully familiar.
This is supposed to take place in Cactusville, right, which is America, but there's some strange kind of hybrid place that Desperate Dan inhabits that is kind of Cactusville married to Accrington.
Cactusville, for me, was the Wild West in Britain. Now, other people see it as Britain in the Wild West, and they contradicted themselves all the time in the strip, but I never questioned it as a kid. I just took it for granted that in the playground, we went outside and we played cowboys and Indians. And, of course, the gasworks were in the background, so what? You pretended it was Arizona. And I think Desperate Dan was the same. It fulfilled every fantasy you had.
The artist who drew Desperate Dan and who was at the heart of the Dandy's early success was Dudley Dexter Watkins.
Dudley Watkins was probably the greatest humour draftsman this country has ever produced. He could draw anything, literally anything, credibly, in a humour context, or in an adventure context, for that matter.
Each week, I turned to look at Dudley Watkins' stuff, and somehow, what Dudley did was technically perfect, wondrously so. There was a kind of intensity of focus that went into each drawing, and there was that, I think there's that intensity and passion is necessary to reach out and hold the readers.
Watkins was so valued by his employers, DC Thompson, that he was the only artist in their comic empire allowed to sign his strips. Watkins lived and worked in what seemed an unlikely place to produce comic strip magic, Dundee being more famous for jam, jute and journalism than jollity.
And maybe that played its part. Maybe there was a reaction there. It was a dull, foreboding industrial city. So maybe that played its part. I personally think it probably did.
Watkins' employers also seemed improbable patrons of fun. DC Thompson were a family firm of Victorian values and Presbyterian morality who allowed no unions in their fun factory. Yet they were canny operators who made money at the popular end of the newspaper market. And they knew with the Dandy they'd struck comics gold.
I think we can be clear that Thompson's recognised that they got a hit on their hands and they had to come up with another one quite quickly. What they did come up with is the Beano, which came along literally 35 weeks after the Dandy launch.
Pretty much a replica of the Dandy in the style, the mixture of adventure stories, comic strips, text stories. And again, it just hit the market at the right time.
The Beano was an immediate hit with kids. On the front was Big Ego, drawn by Dudley Watkins. And he was once again the magic hand drawing the Beano's first star, the neatly trousered philanthropist, Lord Snooty. Like Desperate Dan, Snooty was a product of the 30s, but this strip fantasised about freeing up the British class system.
Lord Snooty began by wanting to escape the upper crust atmosphere and all the demands of his tutors and his aunt Matilda, and would get changed and put on braces and his street clothes and play with his Ashcan street friends. We should remember that Beano and Dandy were cheap periodical entertainment for kids. They were aimed at a working class audience. And in some of the stories, in fact, Lord Snooty took on something of a champion of the underclasses. And his friends were allowed to actually come and live with him in Bunkerton Castle.
Snooty's appeal to young readers in hungry times was his larder. The good lord always offered the promise of a slap-up feed.
Even back in my days, I can remember you didn't always have enough to eat. So seeing people having too much to eat was a fantasy, and too much of something good to eat was a fantasy.
These gigantic feeds at Bunkerton Castle that Snooty would put on, that we dreamed of. I remember that.
Snooty connected with children because the Fun Factory, with its roots in industrial Dundee, had a real empathy with its working class readers.
The strength of the storytelling, which is really the thing that stands out about Thompson's work, comes from the fact that their editors and their staff writers had a very broad interest and could create characters that tapped into all kinds of cultural and social changes.
Comics would also reflect attitudes to a world beyond Little Britain, to places pink on the map where the sun never set.
This is a change from the city life, Bongo. Yep, the old place hasn't changed much. I'm dying to see Bamboo Town again after all these years abroad.
The Nigger Strut.
Racial stereotypes were a common source of humour in 30s Britain, so it's perhaps no surprise that racist images appeared in the pages of the Dandy and the Beano.
As far as black characters are concerned, the early years are absolutely full of primitive natives doing stupid things. It was not enormously enlightened by today's standards, but those notions of characters in blackface almost were commonplace. It was the parlance of the time in these comics, and the Beano and the Dandy were no different to the rest.
Chinese men had big teeth and slit eyes. The huge lips being given to black characters, we now see as being really ugly and racist. You have to understand the context. Britain had a certain superiority, the idea that we were the empire builders, we'd gone out and civilized the world, and we managed to paint the map pink so that the world was virtually entirely British, or seemed to be, meant that we did have that attitude ingrained and taken for granted in society. It's certainly, looking back now, I think we can see that there was an innocent but still dubious racism operating throughout many of these comics.
A year after the first Beano appeared, war broke out. With Britain under siege, the comics now took on a new and vital role as Thompson's adapted to the situation and made capital out of it. German blockades led to ink and paper shortages, threatening production. And though the Beano and Dandy had to slim down and come out in alternate weeks, creative effort now went into exploiting British distaste for Johnny Foreigner to ridicule the enemy.
I think this is Adi and Hermi, Adolf Hitler and Hermann Göring, the nasty Nazis, as they were called in the comics. Musa de Wop, and they made tremendous fun of these people. Musa was always shown eating spaghetti and lacing up his boots with spaghetti and goose-stepping and the boots fly off. There was great mileage for humour. This is an April Fool one, which is, kick me, I am der April Fool. Yes, it was a strange pidgin German that we used.
Readers found comics as propaganda empowering, for every strip made the enemy look ridiculous, laughable and above all, beatable.
As a kid in the street, there's nothing much you could do but hear from your parents about the news about the war. But on the pages of the comic, you could attack the Germans, you could bring their planes down, you could hit their submarines.
DC Thompson's biggest star, Dudley Watkins, was exempted from active service. He was considered so important to bolstering national morale that he spent his war at his desk, sending his characters out to fight for king and country.
This is a Desperate Dan one here, where Dan, he basically feeds ostriches iron, so they lay iron eggs, and he then uses iron eggs in a gigantic pea shooter to shoot down Messerschmitts, which is an everyday tale of wartime.
Lord Snooty and his pals was my ultimate favourite, because they waged a propaganda war on Hitler and Göring, and I used to think this was fantastic. That was Dudley Watkins in his heyday.
When the fighting ended, Thompson's could also celebrate. Not only had the Beano and Dandy survived, with the return of full production, circulation went sky high.
Until, in fact, in 1950, between the Beano and Dandy, they were selling 4 million copies a week. I mean, just an incredible amount. and everything that was printed was sold.
Off the back of their success with the Beano and Dandy, Thompson's launched two new comedy titles, Beeza and Topper. Children of all ages were thrilled. And soldiers returning home from the war brought an unexpected boost for the comics industry.
In 1946, 1947, all the soldiers returning from the front, there was an instant population explosion. So that meant that in the mid-50s, 10 to 12 years after that population explosion, there were probably more kids in the country than there's ever been at any one time. And they had limited outputs for their enjoyment factor. There was no television or anything. The children's comics were the number one thing.
Comics were one of the few things available to kids that offered colour and fun. Post-war children had lots of space, but little else. And for too long into the 50s, the world around seemed a grey and broken place.
The 50s was a bloody terrible decade to live. My memories are all fairly dire. All the women looked like the Queen. They had these sort of home perms. They wore these full dresses. All the blokes had sort back in size. Everybody wore suits and tweeds. Everything stank of smoke. And like the Beano just shines out. It's like a jewel amongst the drop.
Children were hungry for excitement and for something or somebody with a bit of gumption to shake things up a bit. And in 1951, 2 million Beano readers opened their comics and found him, a new hero for their times.
Now, children, go out and collect as much jumble as you can. Cast-off clothing, old furniture, crockery, anything at all.
The sale was organised by the local dignitary, who went by the name of Lady Macbeth.
Yeah, what a shower of drips.
Dennis, the ultimate anarchist, is sneering at them, what a shower of drips.
Dennis the Menace was a character never seen before in British comics. He was restless, impatient, and above all, naughty. Just the way Dennis looked was exciting.
Visually, it was quite different. It was almost crude. It was bursting with life and seemed to do away with conventions of previous comics.
And most importantly, set in a very real, identifiable, ordinary world. There weren't magical elements going on here. It was definitely the world of the reader.
The hero was anti-establishment, somebody that the kids could really relate to. And clearly not somebody that your parents would approve of.
He was an iconic figure as well, you know, with his red and black striped jersey. It made him very identifiable and his rough hair. And just the way he was just always looking for pranks to do, you know, he's always looking to be a nuisance. And that just appeals to every kid, doesn't it?
The artist who created Dennis was Davy Law. A demobbed soldier and father to young children, Law had a natural connection with a new generation of comics fans. He was an obsessive man who worried about the quality of his artwork. But it was exactly this twitchy, nervous side to him that gave Dennis such life.
Davy Law didn't bother too much about background. A curb of a street or a door would be enough, but Dennis was there, and it was very much in his actions. There was a slight exaggeration when he was jumping, or he used the low horizon so much.
It means you're down with the characters. You know, you're on their level. And I think that's what it did. The Beano was always down on the kids' level and saw everything from their perspective. So, you know, adults were always angry and fearful and a force, you know, to be dealt with.
Dennis's mission in life was to cause as much trouble as possible for adults. But there was always a strict moral line taken by the editors of the Beano. True to life, the naughty boy got punished. And in the 50s, that meant getting whacked.
In those days, children were bossed around considerably. Everybody felt they had a perfect right to tell you off and tell you you shouldn't do this and even, you know, to take hold of you and go clonk like that if they felt you were being cheeky or silly or whatever.
So you lived in this fear of violence, and it was always accepted, you know, this violence against children is perfectly, not only acceptable, it's God's just wrath on those who misbehave.
You wouldn't get away with this now. The court will punish me. Fantastic.
But Dennis always bounced back with new ways to frustrate the grown-ups. He knew, as did the readers, that the punishments were pointless.
He never hurt.
No.
There was no pain involved at all.
Too tough to be hurt anyway, really.
There's no pain involved.
Yeah. The readers responded very quickly. They could immediately tell this was something different and special. The feedback from readers, the votes for their favourite characters started to pour into Thompson's offices, and the editor realised this was something that was going to catch on in a big way.
And it wasn't just the young fans of Dennis who were captivated. In a small semi in Preston, Lancashire, an aspiring comics artist, Leo Baxendale, had a revelation when he picked up his younger brother's copy of The Beano.
So I just picked it up. Flicked it over and expecting to see the same old stuff, Lord Snooty and so on. And there was a jolt of excitement, and there was this two-thirds page Dennis. I didn't know who had drawn it, but it was very different what had gone before. And I thought, this is great. This is wonderful. This is vibrant. And I thought, if they'll print this, they might print what I can do.
Baxendale sent some work up to Dundee. Thompson's immediately spotted his potential, and it was the beginning of a stormy but fruitful partnership. Baxendale created his first character for the Beano in 1953, Little Plum, a cross between Dennis the Menace and Hiawatha. Baxendale's strips would now take comics to a new level of sophistication in both style and humour.
Little Plum was a world of thirsty deserts and hungry vultures with knives and forks and all that stuff and 10,000-foot drops. And Plum was a puny creature in this dangerous world, and he had to be cunning and sneaky and treacherous to survive. And he did.
And this has got one of my favourite cartoons of all time. And this is where Plum orders a new car. I mean, the story is completely ludicrous. But the story, that's what I love about the story. They're always very simple and deliberate and, you know, Plum buys a new car. Here comes this huge car. And of course, the car he's bought for $200, no, he's got it's in the boot. It's like a sort of pram. So he gets this thing and it goes, all it does is make a lot of smoke and sort of destroy the neighbourhood.
Baxendale gave Plum a different kind of manic energy to Dennis. He milked his gormless hero and everything in his mad, wild world for maximum comic effect. He also invented elaborate subplots with lots of jokes and running gags for all keen-eyed readers to follow.
Baxendale knows how complex a comic really can be, that it might have a fairly simplistic central sort of strand of a story, but there's all kinds of extra gags, all kinds of extra detours that the story can take. And Baxendale was able to embroider his own scripts and those of others into a marvellous choreography where you literally perform from one pound to the next and a whole cycle of brilliant escalating humour.
Some bloke comes up, scrap motion, says, I'll give you a goldfish for the lot, Plum. Clunk, clank. Me thinks me been swindled with this jalopy. No, you never say. Never say the definite article, always And then there's a Mexican stereotype passing on a mule, says, the little Plum, can I give you the lift? He's being overtaken by this thing. It shows you Leo's obsessive love for detail. The fact he'll do a sort of panoramic scene, Wild West scene, with like bears up to tricks. There's all sorts of eagles doing strange things, and it's really beautifully conceived, and the drawing's absolutely exquisite. And you just pour. What I love about comics, I loved about comics then, is comics you just don't take in at one read. It's not about the punchline, though that's good and strong anyway. But it's the fact that you can go back over it again and again and pour over it and find more things in it.
The comic It isn't like television or anything like that. It's a world of intimate delights. It's held in the hand. I was always aware of that, that what I was drawing would be held in the hand of one child.
Little Plum was such a hit that the Beano asked Baxendale to come up with a female version of Dennis the Menace, a character to appeal to girls as much as boys. His response was Minnie the Minx.
They decided she would be an Amazonian warrior, street fighting woman. I didn't give Minnie any particular superhuman strength. She was a robust 12-year-old girl. What I gave Minnie was intensity of will, and that carried her through everything.
Here is little Minnie, and she's wandering along. And she actually looks very chic because she's got red and black striped jersey, a blackberry with a red pom-pom, quite a short little black skirt and little black socks. I think she dresses in quite a cool way.
We're looking at a period of the early 50s, 53, when Minnie the Minx arrived, of, in theory, conformity. Women meant to be back in the home, back in the kitchen, and certainly girls being prepared at school and in society for being well-behaved and conforming. And in many ways, Minnie the Minx can be seen to be someone that really is completely opposite to that. She doesn't even like wearing dresses very much.
So she rushes up to these boys and says, "Hey, lads, come and have a sweet." And they say, "Run for it, fellas, it's one of her traps." And she's got a little gleam in this side of this picture strip. And it goes, biff, bash, bonk, bonk, splash. And there's all the boys flying as she bashes them all, kicks them all.
The hot-headed Minnie fought tooth and claw against the massed armies of maleness that vainly tried to keep her down. From local gangs of boys to headmasters, careers officers and policemen.
Maybe all the sort of feminists of the 70s, actually in the 50s, read these stories and thought, wow, this is the way to show people. But it's odd, when you look back at some of the comic strips, these were not naughty little girls. They were little girls just, you know, fighting to make themselves heard or to get a really irritating dad to take any notice of them.
Far and away, the most mini-sets I did were this close-focused struggle with her father. And I had to make Minnie's dad tall and robust and strong to be a fit foe for Minnie.
It was in the final panel of the mini-strips that Baxendale veered away from the moral universe of Dennis, offering more subversive endings. Where Dennis was punished, Minnie escaped. Very often she had the last word, something children in the 50s were rarely allowed.
In the 1950s, you were very much kept in your place, and children don't really want to be seen and not heard, so this was a way that they could change things around so that their feelings could be heard.
I didn't want Minnie to be punished for what she did because I thought what she did was exemplary. So it would have been pointless for me to work against that.
Dennis against his dad, Minnie against the world. The Beano was now developing a cheeky streak. Its humour fighting conformity with a very British kind of rebellion.
Kids causing trouble, having no respect for policemen or teachers or adults, park keepers, that's deeply rooted. The French, if they're angry, they go out on the street straight away, they mobilise. The British produce comics.
Just about every strip in the Beano and the Dandy is anti-authoritarian to various degrees, whether it's trying to get one over on your parents in Dennis the Menace's case or trying to get the better of teacher for the Bash Street kids.
For Baxendale's next Beano strip, he turned to the one thing uniting children both in sorrow and in anger, school. The Bash Street Kids became the most popular of all his creations, the perfect expression of his instinctive distrust of authority and hierarchy. Bash Street began life on the 13th of February 1954, under the rather less catchy title of When the Bell Rings.
the sheer inhibition of Bashreet was in that first set. But there were only three recognisable characters. There was Danny, Desai Danny, and Toots. And there was Fatty, but he didn't have a name.
In the first strips, When the Bell Rings showed a whole school going mad. Then Leo had a brainwave.
I thought, no, I'll get rid of this whole school and I'll come into close focus on one class and less than a class, this group of named characters, so that I can bring them closer and closer to the readers.
Over a period of months, the lunatic lineup of the Bashreet gang emerged, with Baxendale offering a choice of role models to his readers.
I think we all wanted to be Danny, because he was cool and he was in charge. I kind of like the visually, I like the look of Wilfred. Any kid who was anyway challenged around his teeth would become Plug.
And it created Plug as a tall creature, but it was a kind of looming presence. And then after some weeks, I thought, no, that's not Plug, it's not right. And it came to me what he had to be. Because I called him Plug from the phrase Plug Ugly, and he was ugly, and he got uglier as the years went by, it came to me that it had the inner core of Plug's existence in his mind was that to himself, he was a radiant being.
The Bashreet kids were teachers' worst nightmare, a gang of untamable gremlins trampling over all attempts to educate them. This was a child's fantasy of revenge, a safety valve for those experiencing school in the 1950s.
School was horrible in those days. It's bloody terrible. Teachers were bastards.
I mean, my brother used to come back from school with great large red marks on his legs because someone who really did resemble teacher in the Bashreet kids used to whack him. I mean, my brother wasn't a naughty boy, but I mean, he just got whacked mercilessly by this bloke with a whacking great big plimsoll.
With a less gifted artist, the Bashreet teacher would have simply been a bully. But Baxendale understood that the situation in the strip was more complicated. Teacher could be both authority figure and underdog.
The Bashreet teacher was permanently between a rock and a hard place. The headmaster on one side and Bashreet kids on the other. That's what it comes down to. Bashreet teacher was stuck.
That teacher was a complex character was clear when Baxendale gave readers a glimpse of his life at home.
At one point in an episode, the teacher is driving past his home, and Baxendale puts wonderful details in, like, for example, the gateposts to the house have mortarboards on them, and then there are great piles of homework sitting in the dustbins at the side of the house. So there's a whole world of the teacher that it gradually emerges that are clues to his character and his life.
Crucially, there's teacher's wife in the window holding up his lunch. Bangers and mash, of course. Now she looks exactly like teacher. She's got teacher's moustache and that raises the question, was teacher married to his sister?
Few children would have picked up on that kind of ambiguity. But for Baxendale, art was his way of knifing the system. Something his employers, D.C. Thompsons, were not always happy with.
He was actually, in many ways, pushing the boundaries. There was always a certain tension, in fact, between Baxendale and Thompsons. He wanted to be able to go further, to go into more goonish and crazy areas than perhaps Thompsons were quite ready for.
I'm forever looking at the system I live in and probing at it and poking it and see what happens.
The innovation and creative passion pouring into the Beano meant the comic had become a shared world of in-jokes and subversive delights. Readers could hardly wait for their weekly fix.
It was something to look forward to all week. And the sight of a new cover was, you know, oh God, it's there, I've got to have it. You know, it's like it was, the Beano was a kind of crack cocaine of its day. You know, once you were hooked, you were totally bloody hooked.
With television yet to dominate the lives of children, the Beano influenced a generation of budding cartoonists, filmmakers and writers.
We used to get the Beano sent to us. I can't remember which days the comics came out, but it was very, very lovely. And you'd have, I know, a jam sandwich. You'd curl up in your armchair and you read your Beano. It was great.
They'd all come on a particular day. I've forgotten which day of the week it was. Probably Tuesday, I think. And, of course, it was great because it really livens up Tuesday. It's bloody boring otherwise. And I wouldn't take it to school. I'd save it up and read it later. I'm pretty sure I would. And it was a sort of just a world you could go into and just read avidly.
I would go to my grandma's house every Saturday, and our treat would be to get our comics. It was such a treat to get my Beano every Saturday. And once I got it, you couldn't disturb me. I had to go somewhere quiet and read it from cover to cover. And I just loved being in that world.
Dandyland and Beano World were so real that all your favourite characters read the same comics. You were all one gang laughing at the same jokes.
Yes.
What I find strange is that you'd sometimes get a character in the Beano, like reading the comic, and you'd read like guffaw, guffaw, or, you know, ho, ho, ho. But as a child, I never laughed ever. You were serious when you were reading it. I think you were laughing inside or something.
And once you'd digested your comic in seclusion, you could add it to your growing collection. Or you could use it as hard currency in the booming junior stock exchange.
Swapping in the playground was a big, big number. There were second-hand, third-hand, fourth-hand, fifth-hand copies of these comics, and you always had to have something to swap. It was a big part of school culture.
Beano Annual was booty. It was. You could trade Beano Annual for almost anything in a playground when I was a kid, because it had so much entertainment value in it.
The world of comics was a mysterious place for grown-ups. They thought of them with the same suspicion many now see computer games, a waste of time, and probably bad for you.
I was taken aside one day in the playground when I was excitedly discussing something that happened in a comic, and the teacher did say to me, "Oh, for heaven's sake, Jacqueline, will you just put that trashy thing to one side?" And so they were looked on as something, you know, very, very inferior.
Of course, looking back on it, I can now see that there was a hierarchy. There was, like, you know, Beatrix Potter and good literature. Then below it was the Eagle. That's kind of good but not quite so good. And then below that there was the Beano and the Dandy.
The adults just didn't get it. They didn't understand the complexity of comics. And they certainly missed the subtle visual grammar employed by artists of the imagination of Leo Baxendale.
If you're not used to it, it's quite a strain because, I mean, you read the sort of heading bit whilst looking at the pictures, and then you've got to read probably the left speech bubble first before the right one, and then there might even be another speech bubble underneath.
But then there are these other little bits, these sounds and things. Well, who narrates those? All right, that you don't know. And there's sometimes these little gags, these little arrows that point and say, smell.
Nip with it by the...
And the biggest joke of all was an inability to see that comics were an excellent way of getting reluctant children to read, on their own terms and at their own pace.
I found it a kind of almost like a release, really. I could, you know, I didn't have to read. I found pages full of writing hard work, and suddenly I felt freer and able to follow stories, and there wasn't that burden of having to take it all into my brain.
By the end of the 50s, post-war rationing and penny-pinching were swept away in a consumer boom, and the more confident, optimistic mood in Britain was reflected in a new kind of humour.
$4,000 within the hour. I'm going to get killed.
Oh, what's the time now?
2 o'clock.
Oh, don't worry, boss. I'll ring Dick.
In the world where adults laughed, a surreal satirical group called Dick. The Goons had become superstars. In Beano Land, a glorious new strip shared their madcap humour.
Jonah essentially is a jinx. He's a sailor who, when he comes on board any vessel, there's a complete panic breaks out because everyone knows he's going to sink that ship.
This is like classical tragedy, you know. It's always the same bloody story. We always know what's going to happen, but the way it happens, different time, each time. It always ends up, it's him, and then...
The artist behind Jonah was Ken Reed, an eccentric figure and the last creative genius of the Fun Factory.
Ken Reed was probably my favourite. Came from Manchester, and he was one of these boy wonders who could draw from the age of three, you know.
Most people would have think he was be a bit of a character. He kept a lot of pets. He's had toads, frogs, hamsters, mice, an iguana, lizard, tortoise.
His favourite treat in the pub was a walnut whip washed down by a black and tan. That was Ken Reed's favourite, that one.
Reed had drawn Roger the Dodger and many other successful strips, but with Jonah, he tapped into something mad inside him and brought the character to life with brilliant draftsmanship.
The ships were always quite accurately drawn, but I know that he had reference books of at the time, the boy's book on ships or something, and he'd be able to know what was a trawler and a tug.
But sometimes you had to mix it up a bit. For instance, we've sunk a destroyer, an aircraft carrier, two fishing boats and a liner. What are we going to do this week?
Good evening. Richard Dimbleby reporting from a hovercraft on Southampton Water.
With few conventional vessels left to sink, Beano scriptwriters turned to the latest amphibian fad in go-ahead Britain.
A new type of hovercraft, is ahead of its time, is about to be put through its initial tests on Lake Lindenmere. Hope your new design merits the money we put into the project, Professor Plankworthy. Have no fear, Sir Frumpsby.
But no one notices Jonah boarding the hovercraft from the other side. I fancy a trip in one of these. Until...
Goodness, the engine started. She's coming at us. Look, which knob stops this? No, stop! Can't! Blimey! Agh! Crash!
Look at this panel here. These characters are all reacting to the action that's going on. They're the most peculiar creatures you've ever seen. So he's really taking the idea of what people will look like and stretching them to the furthest elements of caricature.
You can imagine him walking into a bus with his pad and pen and sort of saying, that's a face, I can use him, you know.
His characters, they all sweated a lot, or they spat. There was a spit coming in their mouth. It was very amusing to me as a kid. And these kind of imbecile expressions on Jonah's face. I just loved it. It almost had a kind of voodoo effect on me as a kid.
The kinetic, splenetic energy of Jonah demanded an immense effort of research and drawing. Reed got so carried away, he would always deliver far more than was required by the script.
He was so intense. If you gave him a script of 12 frames, you could be pretty sure he would make 16 out of that, if not 20.
Because he put so much effort into his detailed drawings, so he'd make more work for himself, but it was just the way he was.
Reed, like other artists, worked 52 Beano weeks a year, but in his quest for comic perfection, he pushed himself to a nervous breakdown.
Because there suddenly came a point where he was faced with a sheet of drawing board and he couldn't draw. And he said that he was suddenly had this feeling of a band of metal tightening round his head.
I know he had a breakdown, and I put it down to overwork, because he was doing so much stuff. He wasn't just doing Jonah. He was doing, like, about four or five strips, I think. He just couldn't pick a pen up. And that's when I think that picture is perhaps trying to express the way he felt, that it was just going on forever.
Leo Baxendale was younger and fitter, but he was also pushed to the point of collapse.
The big danger for me was the constant collision between the intensity that went into the drawings and the passion and the downloading of the nervous system and the sheer scale of output. And you drifted into a position where you did without sleep, and it's illogical to do something that requires intense energy and focus while exhausted.
The whole comic is like a combine harvester. It never stops. There's never a break from it. It's like produce masterpiece, masterpiece, masterpiece.
But with pain came little gain to the bank balance. Artists and writers had no claim to authorship or control over their work.
Management for all the main publishers in Britain always regarded the creative people as serfs, almost. There was somebody at DC Thompson's and IPC who would have to look over the artwork to make sure that signatures were whited out, because we can't let the artists have any credits. Goodness knows, they might ask more money.
The copyright to all characters was owned by the companies, so artwork could be reprinted without any further payment to those who'd created the strips.
Imagine the Beatles do a song and they get paid for that song, and then that's it.
By 1963, Leo Baxendale felt the relentless demands of the Fun Factory were affecting the quality of his work, and after an argument over a drawing, he left. The partnership between free-spirited artist and moralistic employer was over.
I always felt that setup was wrongly handled. Compromise should have been the order of the day. No way should they have let Baxendale go. He was their golden goose.
But strips like Bash Street had made Baxendale a hot property in a still booming comics industry. A London publisher, Audums, took him on to create a new comic. Leo called it Wham! Wham! Was to be a super beano that would be fresh and funny for children of the 60s.
Wham! Coming out was a big event. I can remember us all rushing to the newsstand to buy it.
The cover looks like a sound effect from a comic. It wasn't anything like the slightly archaic titles like Beezer, Topper and Beano. This was definitely a modern 60s title.
Leo Baxendale was given a free hand. He could create a comic from scratch. If you look at something like that, it's wild stuff, isn't it?
He tapped into the 60s crazes, things like super spies and secret agents, the whole Man from U.N.C.L.E. and James Bond thing ended up with the Eagle Eye Junior Spy. He's still a kid character, of course, but he was up against all kinds of crazy villains like Grimly Fiendish.
Grimly Fiendish was a supernatural being, and it was a wonderful character to draw. I mean, I don't believe in any kind of supernatural beings, but they make wonderful comic characters.
And then, reflecting the 60s vogue for monsters, came Frankenstein, the work of fellow Beano artist Ken Reed, who Leo had poached from DC Thompson.
The point is that much of Thompson's approach to comedy didn't really allow for horror. It didn't allow for kind of grotesque things. Even things like certain sort of animals and snakes and things weren't really allowed in the comics. It was all meant to be relatively safe. So Reed here was able to cut loose in a way that he hadn't been able to under Thompson's control.
But Reed drew only three strips for Wham! Baxendale had to come up with the rest. He'd been promised creative control, but was forced by Audums to include copycat ideas.
The Tiddlers, that was a takeoff of Bash Street School. They wanted a Bash Street type thing. Danny Dare, that was suggested by Audums, and it was a takeoff of Dan Dare.
Worse still, the quality of Wham! Was compromised when the comic's format was changed.
The trouble was that Audums doubled the page pagination of Wham! To 27 pages, but we didn't have twice as many artists. And I started off trying to draw everything, which was all right until we went into production, and then a great many ghost artists were drafted in.
You can always tell when Maxwell has drawn, or particularly proud of it, because he does sign it. This was a rare instance in British comics for artists to be allowed to sign their work. So on Eagle Eye here, for example, in full colour, it is signed. But looking further ahead here, Danny Dare, who was the ultimate number one fan of Dan Dare, wasn't an invention of Baxendale's and not actually fully drawn by him.
It's just getting a bit thin. Can you see? Can you tell there's only 9 frames on a page? The backgrounds are thin. There's still the wonderful actions and everything, but it's lacking something.
Lack of time was the bane of artists in an industry whose demand for profit always put quantity before quality.
So, I didn't steal all that now. Ironic, isn't it? Frying pan into the fire.
After his problems at Wham, Baxendale faced the same conflict between art and commerce when he was taken on by a new publishing giant, IPC.
Snow on the roof, of course.
Snow on the roof.
Can we change to Blackburns and Robins?
IPC were an ambitious company, keen to exploit the still lucrative market for children's comics.
I'll put one Robin in.
Let Roy have a Robin.
Oh, come
on. All right, one Raven and one Robin, then.
The young Bob Painter was the editor of their flagship new comic with a twist.
I started with Whizzer and Chips, which was a revolutionary comic, being that it was two comics in one. The idea being that you was either a whiz kid or a chipite, and you took the comic and took it in half and you read the bit that you liked.
Whizzer and Chips made money, so IPC immediately followed up with a blitzkrieg of new titles.
In the era beginning 1969, the comics were Whizzer and Chips, Core, Shiver and Shake, Monster Fun, Knockout, School Fun, Nipper, Wow, Jackpot, Whoopee.
Well, probably the IPC humour comics, there was a sort of cynicism about how you produce them. They had a formula. It was described to me, actually, in the offices there. Kevin, what you've got to understand is this is a sausage factory. You put the scripts and the artwork in one end, and a funny comic comes out the other end. Well, it didn't actually work like that.
It is my era. It is. And I bought this comic when it came out. It does a job. It entertains you. But it's not inspiring.
Leo Baxendale's work was now so influential in the comics industry that IPC was full of Baxendale imitators.
But they don't have the same creativity, that same spark of genius that Baxendale had.
Into the 1970s, the original Fun Factory in Dundee was still thriving. Despite the absence of Baxendale and Reed, it had managed to draw in a new generation of readers.
What's your favourite comic?
Beano.
And what do you like best about Beano?
Billy the Cat, Biffo the Bear, the Three Bears.
Little Plum, the Bash Street Kids.
Well, I loved the Bash Street Kids. They were fantastic. That was great when you got that kind of thing. Something to cut out. The janitor. I missed that one. I would have loved to cut out janitor. And Roger the Dodger was one of my favourites too. But that's a different artist to what I remember.
Although the great artists of DC Thompson's golden age of comics were gone, their iconic characters lived on through the work of ghost artists.
We were able to keep this going because we knew how to put a comic together and we knew the energy it required, so we could find replacement artists that were probably not as funny and or as good as these originals. They were not, I would say. But they had their own style, which we developed.
But while the classic strips still worked their magic, there was no new Baxendale coming to the Beano and Dandy to bring fresh flair and invention. And now the whole comics industry began to face social and cultural changes that were simply beyond its control.
From mid to late 70s, the sales-wise, we were taking a pounding. And it was just there was just so many things for kids to spend money on, spend time on, to be amused by, television. I mean, it was the coming of computer age. It was just massive.
Leo Baxendale was still drawing for IPC, But sensing the market for children's comics was collapsing, he decided on one last strip.
The Bad Time Bedtime books, I'd already decided that the comic industry was going to fail, so I had to make a strategic plan. And there weren't many new comics being produced, so I thought, I need to do something that's very, very good, as good or better, and new. Because I was no longer 22, I was in my 40s, you know. I could see it all draining away.
Baxendale's bedtime stories were his final treat for young readers. It was his way of switching off the lights on what had been a glorious career in comics. Into the 80s, circulation for children's comics continued to fall. Many disappeared forever. But the comics which had sparked the original revolution battled on. In 1987, the first revolutionary celebrated his 50th birthday. Without question, Dan was now a national treasure.
If I were to say to you, what's Desperate Dan's favourite meal?
Cow pie.
It was cow pie.
Cow pie. And why does everybody know that? Because he's an icon.
But what made Dan the man he was, his massive appetite and extravagant lifestyle, was about to be neutered by the emergence of a new moral climate.
There is no doubt in my mind that political correctness and sanitization of the comics was yet another nail in the coffin. Like, our speciality was outrageous, anarchistic behaviour. And when that had to stop and you had to dumb the thing down, the real sharp edge was removed.
Desperate Dan just about neutered with political correctness.
Because the cow pie was a big problem.
The cow pie was a problem. And it would be a double problem now with childhood obesity. But at that time, we went through the mad cow disease problem. Couldn't touch the cow pie. Dan smoked everything that he could lay his hands on. It was a problem.
Ate endangered species, too.
He ate endangered species all the time. I mean, it just about neutered Dan. Political correctness, you couldn't do Dans of the quality of the ones in the past. Because that's what it relied on. It relied on that large-in-life, huge, over-the-top thing.
A more touchy-feely, politically correct Dan has hung on to collect his pension. As the Dandy and Beano look forward to celebrating their 70th birthdays. The circulation isn't what it used to be, but that's age for you. But the survival of these wonderful creations remind us that children's comics of the Golden Age stand as one of the great achievements of British popular culture.
Comics Britannia dedicates this programme to the memory of Beano and Dandy writer Ian Gray, who died last week.